Rood Awakening.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. We appreciate you coming in this morning. First off, the big question I know that everyone out there is asking, do you have enough bread and milk to get through the next couple days for the snow?
Yes, I think I actually got 2 loaves of bread and a gallon and a half of milk.
Good, so. You should be good.
You know, that should be enough. There's 4 kids at home, though.
Well,
you know.
See, you may not have enough there. I have one child, and he drinks, I think, a gallon of milk a day. No, Brad, you're running for Knox County Board of Education, District 6.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Why would you do that to yourself? Why are you getting in the middle of this quagmire we know as the Board of Education?
Getting in the middle of this quagmire that we know as a Board of Education is one of the reasons that I'm doing this. Mm-hmm. I think that you've heard a lot of people being vocal lately about the Common Core.
Mm-hmm.
And I think especially being married to a teacher, mm-hmm. having an education degree, having taught myself, and hearing the things that are going on in the classroom, and hearing the teachers speak, and seeing the reaction, the initial reaction of the board, mm-hmm. you know, of our current superintendent to that, wasn't a pleasant thing for me. You know, when I saw their reactions, you know, the Karen Carson thing you mentioned earlier this morning, you know, doesn't come as a surprise for me. And watching the stuff that they've got streaming on their site, there's a discussion about the latest survey that they've passed out that came back as, you know, mm-hmm. everyone knows now, you know, very negatively.
Sure.
About the attitudes of the teachers. When they were discussing distributing that, I mean, there were jokes made about, you know, should we certify that we don't have someone doing handwriting analysis so that we can't identify the teachers? You know, and this is posted on the website for, you know, citizens and, I mean, everyone to look at.
Yeah.
And so that just seems to be the general attitude.
What we get a lot of, and all joking aside, because we take a lot of this with a grain of salt, and we do a lot of it kind of tongue in cheek, because if we sat here and talked about how very disparaging a lot of this stuff comes out seeming, it seems like they kind of sit back with that attitude of, we don't really care. We don't really care what you have to say. We're going to do our job. We're going to let McIntyre do whatever he wants to do, and we're just kind of laughing at you. And it scares me in the fact that it doesn't. The Board of Education is not focused on our kids' education. It's everything else but that. At times, the first thing I want to ask you. There's this weird dichotomy of power there. Who works for whom? Does the board work for the superintendent? Does a superintendent work for the board? Who answers to who? As it stands right now.
You know, as it stands right now and seeing the way the vote went to extend McIntyre's contract, it feels to me like the board is working for the superintendent at this mm-hmm. point in time. And the board really needs to reclaim that power which is theirs, you know, get in there and start acting the way that the voters that put you in there mm-hmm. want you to act. Start speaking out for our kids.
Yeah.
You know, it seems to me, I don't know if it's fear, I don't know if it's apathy, but it seems to me to just be a general inaction and then just kind of standing by and, you know, yays and, you know, yays, few nays, and just let it move on and, you know. That's the way it should go.
Yeah, yeah. Because, I mean, the board does hire the superintendent. So the superintendent should answer to the board.
Yeah, you would think so. You would think so. But, you know, but like I said, especially when you hear the, the opinions of the teachers, the opinions of, the taxpayers mm-hmm. here, you know, the way they feel about McIntyre's contract being extended, you know, it seems to me that the board wasn't listening to the people.
Sure.
You know, and it seems to me, too, that the board wasn't considering our kids' education first thing.
Sure. In your opinion, should the superintendent be an elected position or should it still be handled by the Board of Education?
So I've gone back and forth on this. You know, there's a part of me that likes the idea of it being an elected position, and that person being held directly, responsible to the taxpayers and having to be elected. At the same time, there's a part of me that says that is a functional position that needs to be running the schools and needs to be in there on a daily basis. And that's kind of one of the complaints I have about, our current superintendent is he doesn't really seem to be in there and active in running the schools. And so the idea of someone needing to politic, once every 4 years, take a year off so they can politic, doesn't feel good to me.
Sure.
So I think at this point in time, I think appointed is appropriate. Now, at the same time, I think that if you've got an active school board that's in there that's making the right decisions, if you're not brought good candidates by whatever recruiting company, they bring, then you need to say, we don't have any good candidates here. You either need to bring us someone else, or we need to open this up and just make this a public posting, because we're not seeing who the people of Knox County would want in this role.
If it is kept as an appointed position or as a hired position by the board, then definitely the person who's there should be much more accountable to the board.
To the board, exactly.
And in turn, the board should be much more accountable to its constituents.
To the people. That's it, exactly.
You were a teacher, yes?
Yes, I was a teacher. I've spent a total of 4 years in the classroom up in northeast Tennessee, Carter County and Hawkins County, up at a volunteer high school for 3 years. Started keyboarding. Went in to computers, turned in a grant, helped get the school, actually physically wired the school for the internet. Got some students to help me out with that. And then we were wired on the internet. Nobody had computers.
Yeah.
So got some students and taught them how to build computers.
Yeah.
We built computers, so then we had computers.
Yeah.
It was a good all-around program. One of my students came back to me kind of shy down the hall one day toward the end of the year and handed me a note, a little box of chocolates. And it was one of those notes from his mom, and just a thank you note that said, "Hey, thanks for everything you did."
Yeah.
Because we didn't think he was going to make it, and this is one of the students that I worked with, helped build computers, helped get him a job with a local business building computers, and he was very happy, and I could see that when he started with me. He just seemed like one of those guys that didn't seem to have a path. So so having that freedom in the classroom to be able to pick up and say, this is what's going to motivate this kid. And not only this is what's going to motivate this kid, but, this is going to help get technology in this school. Yeah. This is going to help get these kids on the internet. And, sure. Having that freedom to do that was great.
Well, that's a wonderful story. That's a great story to hear because we talk all the time. Good teachers, all of us have had, and I'm sure you've probably had in your past, a great teacher, one or two teachers that really affected your life in some profound way, you know. And it's amazing because you talk to everybody, and almost every person you talk to has had that one teacher that just stood out. And it may not even be a subject that you really, that even has any big bearing on your life right now, but just a teacher that stuck out and said, "Hey, I see something else there." And they become almost more than a teacher, and they change your life in profound ways that you may not even realize till years later. Who was that teacher for you?
Yeah, I would say that teacher for me was my high school computer teacher. I'm an IT guy now, that teacher saw in me early on that I really enjoyed computers, I really enjoyed programming, and saw that I wasn't going to be challenged by the stuff that she was presenting in class. And so she looked at me and she said, "Well, we've got this program that we use, and it doesn't run on our current computers. So can you sit down and here's the source code for it. These are the days when we used to hack source code stuff.
Sure.
And can you get this converted so we can run it on our current computers?"
Yeah.
And I dug right in on that. And that was great to have, once again, that freedom and that opportunity to do that. Because that lets you know what you love.
Do you think teachers get that ability to do things like that anymore?
Absolutely not. And as I talk to people about the Common Core, the new, how it's so rigorous and everything, so something people say, "Well, it's not that bad. You just can't do that pirate unit anymore, or the pajama day anymore." But you know, I've got kids at home, and I see that that pirate unit can get those kids psyched up about education,
sure,
and can get those kids into learning stuff. I mean, for a whole week, I mean, it holds their attention, and to hear that they were excited, to go to school, and they were so revved up to know that their eyes, their ears, their minds are just open because of that one little thing.
Sure.
I mean, and if you take that away, what's left?
It's an amazing thing to watch when kids are excited about learning something.
Oh, absolutely.
It's an awesome thing, and unfortunately, I don't see that much anymore, especially with my own kids. It's,
right.
Oh, it's another day of school.
Yeah, exactly. Another dreaded day of school, another test.
Yeah. Incredible stuff. We're talking with Bradley Buchanan. He is running for District 6, the Knox County Board of Education. We'll talk to him some more coming up. We'll also let you know, you heard Freebird coming in. We're going to explain the Freebird story coming. 6 minutes left to go in this hour. Talking with Bradley Buchanan. He is a candidate for the Knox County Board of Education, District 6. Where is District 6?
District 6 is, looking at the voting district part of it, it's the Carnes area, okay, all the way out Hardin Valley, then all the way down Lovell Road to Kingston Pike.
Okay. New middle school, you guys need one out there?
We've got, you know, we've got Carnes over capacity. But I'll tell you also, you know, in that district, there's a lot of facility needs inside of Washington County, period.
Sure.
We've got too many of these mobile buildings sitting outside of the schools, mobile buildings that don't have any plumbing, don't have any water in them, sitting in elementary schools.
Yeah.
You know, so we're sending, you know, elementary age kids, you know, these are first and second graders outside to go into the main building to use the restroom.
Really?
You know, having to send them in pairs to be... to be safe. You know, there's something that's, as a parent, that concerns me.
Sure.
You know, that
sure.
That in this day and age, you know these kids, and they make the mobile units with bathrooms in it, even, you know, and why they are the way they are, I don't know. You know, these are the things that I'd like the opportunity to dig in a little bit deeper on, you know, and to ask the people the questions.
Sure. Yeah, because that's been the big discussion in the past couple of weeks, is the fact that, and Mayor Burchett throwing a support behind that, you know, in the Hardin Valley area especially, needing a new school, because I guess what, four schools there right now, and they're all running at
80%
capacity, yeah, or more. So right now seems to be the right time to look at building something. So in the event that if and when, because it's not a question of if, when they do have more people moving into the area out there, suddenly, you know, your 80% capacity suddenly turns into 100% capacity or 95% capacity. By that time, it's too late to go, oh, we need another school now.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, it's a long process for them to get a school put together. And this,
sure,
is something that Mayor Burchett and Brad Anders came out and spoke to the Hardin Valley Needs a Middle School group earlier this week, and,
sure,
and explained to them, you know, so they do need to start looking for some land, start getting the capital planning in place,
sure,
you know, to do this, get on that 5-year plan to get a school built out there. You know, geographically, you know, does it make sense to have it out there? Absolutely.
Sure.
You know, to me and in my mind, and from what I heard from, you know, Burchett and Anders, was, you know, that's a long-term play.
Mm-hmm.
And as I'm out there visiting these schools and talking to these parents, you know, there's a lot of, you know, immediate needs at this point in time. Some things we need to pay attention to on the facility side. We need not just build these buildings and just let them stand there.
Sure.
You know, we need to keep these things up. We need to make sure that, you know, we don't have to meet, you know, small groups, you know, in teacher restrooms and out in hallways underneath stairwells. So, you know, let's make sure that the facilities that we do have here are good,
sure,
while we're planning and getting this stuff in line for the new facilities.
Well, if anybody can do it, Tim Burchett's a good person to have behind it, because he did a pretty good job at Carter. So, real quickly, just something kind of funny here. We're talking with Bradley Buchanan.
We're here today to ask people about marriage.